Very good evening, ladies and gentlemen. It's my pleasure to welcome you all on behalf of AuroLab to this webinar on clinical and surgical management of RDE and non-wall glaucoma implants from AuroLab. We cordially welcome our eminent speakers, Dr. Premanand Chandran, glaucoma consultant, Aravind Eye Hospital, Coimbatore; Dr. Ganesh V. Raman, chief consultant, glaucoma services, Aravind Eye Hospital, Coimbatore; Dr. Sirisha Sendil, faculty and head, VST Glaucoma Center, L.V. Prasad Eye Institute, Hyderabad; Dr. Sushmita Kaushik, Professor, Glaucoma Services, Advanced Eye Center, Postgraduate Institute of Medical Education and Research, Chandigarh. Welcome you all. And I take this opportunity to introduce Dr. Ganesh Raman sir, who is the backbone of this event, and he will be the moderator of this session. Dr. Ganesh Raman is the Chief Consultant of the Glaucoma Services in Aravind Eye Hospital, Coimbatore, and he has extensive experience in glaucoma and cataract procedures, including glaucoma drainage device, GAD, canaloplasty, and device-assisted trabeculectomy procedures. He has numerous papers and poster presentation in various state, national, and international forums, and has to his credit 25 publications in national and international journals. And he has helped us in developing the RDE product along with Dr. George. Now, I request Dr. Ganesh Raman sir to start the webinar. To Dr. Ganesh Raman sir, please.
Thank you. I'll just share my screen. I would like to welcome our speakers, eminent speakers, particularly Dr. Sirisha Sendil. Dr. Sirisha Sendil is the faculty and head VST Glaucoma Center, L.V. Prasad Eye Institute. She did her MS in ophthalmology from Aravind Eye Hospital, Madurai from 1996-1999. And then she did her FRCS from Edinburgh in the year 2000. And then a glaucoma fellowship in L.V. Prasad Eye Institute, where she now heads the department. And she specializes in managing refractory adult and pediatric glaucomas. Her areas of interest are glaucoma drainage implant and secondary glaucomas. She's an investigator for several studies and has published over 125 scientific papers in peer-reviewed journals and authored 20 presentations in the national and national fora. And she has received the best scientific awards and best video awards at Glaucoma Society of India, AIOS, and Asia Pacific Congress and the World Ophthalmology Congress. She, in 2018, she received the American Academy of Ophthalmology Achievement Award. Welcome, Dr. Sirisha Sendil. Next, I would like to welcome Dr. Sushmita Kaushik, Professor of Ophthalmology, Advanced Eye Center, Postgraduate PGI, Chandigarh. She did her MBBS from Maulana Azad Medical College in 1997, Senior Residency and Research Officer there, and then she's a faculty at PGI Chandigarh since 2004. She has 130 publications reputed, indexed international and national journals, and has contributed 32 chapters in various textbooks. So she is also invited member of the World Childhood Glaucoma Research Network, invited member Glaucoma Task Force, Ministry of Health and Government of India, member of the Task Force on Indo-US Joint Proposals, DBT, Government of India, and she has numerous awards, scientific paper in glaucoma, AIOS in the year 2020, best paper awards in various state and zonal conferences, DB Chandra Award for the best glaucoma paper at AIOS in 2008, and best scientific paper at the annual conference of this Glaucoma Society of India at Calcutta, and the best paper at the annual conference of North Zone Ophthalmological Society in Chandigarh 2006, and the best paper award at the annual conference of Glaucoma Society of India in 2004. This is just one page of what Dr. Sirisha and Dr. Sushmita have sent to me. There is many more, and I welcome Dr. Sushmita for joining us for this webinar. Next, I would like to invite a hearty welcome to our consultant, Dr. Premanand Chandran. He's a master's in ophthalmology from RIO GUH, fellowship in glaucoma from L.V. Prasad Eye Institute. He's a student of Dr. Sirisha, and he has also completed the FICO and also the ICO fellowship. And his visual field handbook, it's a very compact visual field handbook for ready reference. It's easily available in Kindle. So he's I and my colleagues and friends here in the department. So a warm welcome to all of you. And with this, I will invite Dr. Premanand Chandran to start off the program by talking to us on step-by-steps of the RD procedure. Over to Dr. Premanand, please.
Are you able to hear me now?
Oh, yes. Good.
Yeah. Are you able to see my slides?
Oh, yes.
Yes. Thanks. Thank you for the kind introduction. So I'll be talking about the various steps that needs to be known regarding the procedure of oral or aqueous drainage implant. Before going into the various steps, so oral or aqueous drainage implant is a non-valved implant. It's made of silicon. Both the plate as well as the tube is made of silicon, and it has a surface area of about 350 millimeters squared, which is almost double the size of the surface area of Ahmed glaucoma valve, which is around 184. And it's more horizontally large in the sense, say the anterior posterior diameter of the plate is around 13 millimeters, whereas horizontally it is 32 millimeters. So that is the reason why you need to put the wings of the plate underneath the muscles. Before proceeding to the various steps of the surgery, the pre-op considerations, preparations is very important when you take these patients for an implant, as these patients are mostly who have refractory glaucomas, who already underwent a TRAB or some other intraocular procedures. So you need to be very knowledgeable, and you need to think prior to taking up the patient for surgery. Before the surgery part, you should know about which quadrant you're going to place the implant. The most preferable quadrant is the superior temporal quadrant, followed by the inferior nasal and the inferior temporal quadrant. And prior gonioscopy is a must, because you need to know where exactly the pass is. So where exactly you're going to put the tube in. These are all very important things which you have to decide prior to taking up the patient for surgery, as well as where you're going to put the tube in, whether you're going to put the tube in the anterior chamber or in the sulcus or in the vitreous cavity. Prior to surgery, give a good peribulbar block, at least 4 to 6 ml of long-lasting anesthetic. And mannitol is mandatory before surgery, provided there is no systemic contraindications, as most of these patients have high IOPs with medications before surgery. And when coming to the steps, so the initial step is to put a corneal traction suture. We use an 8-0 to put the corneal traction suture. We may put one or sometimes two, depends upon the amount of exposure that you require for the surgery. And the next step is to do a conjunctival peritomy. Minimum 2 to 3 clock hours of conjunctival peritomy is required, which is little more than what you do generally for an Ahmed glaucoma valve, because it's more large horizontally. So you need to have a little larger peritomy. And I'll generally prefer a limbal and phonics based conjunctival flap. Provided I am doing putting the tube in the anterior chamber on the sulcus. In case if I'm planning to put the tube in the vitreous cavity, I'll put the conjunctival incision a little about 5 mm from the limbus. And make sure you nicely undermine the conjunctiva, and you have to go up to the rectus and even beyond that, so that you have enough space for the implant to fit in. After conjunctival peritomy, you have to isolate both the muscles. Say, suppose if you're operating in the superior temporal quadrant, you have to isolate the superior rectus and the lateral rectus. And in case if it is an inferior nasal, you have to isolate the adjacent two muscles, the medial as well as the inferior rectus. So isolation is very important. The reason is, say we are going to put the wings underneath the muscle, which is very important procedure, because in case if you didn't put the wings underneath the muscle, you may end up in having motility disorders in the post-operative period. Make sure that you clear off the adhesions underneath the muscle. So you have to isolate the muscle with the help of a muscle hook. And once you're done with it, use two muscle hooks, and the second muscle hook, you just go posteriorly and get rid of all the adhesions, so that your wings nicely fit in your underneath the muscles. After putting the wings underneath the muscle, you have to ligate the tube. Either you can use a 6-0 or 7-0 vicryl. The main difference is 7-0 vicryl will open, the tube will open up around 4 weeks, which is around a month. Whereas if you use a 6-0 vicryl, the tube will open up around 6 weeks, which is 1.5 months. So before ligating the tube, I usually used to check for the patency of the tube. The reason is there may be some manufacturing issues which you have to doubly sure that there is no issues. So once you are done with that, I'll just ligate the tube. You have to tightly ligate to the sense that you have to see a kink in the tube, that there is a clear sign of that there is a complete occlusion. Even after that, you have to again inject some sort of balance salt solution and recheck again that there is no fluid which is coming out. Because since it's a non-valved implant, if there's any leak that is there, it can lead to a hypotony and shallow chambers in the post-operative period. So make sure there is complete ligation is achieved when you. So when I again check it after ligating, there's no fluid which is coming out of the tube. Once the tube is ligated, you can have to put the implant underneath the muscles. Some people may prefer doing the ligation after putting the implant in the subcongenital space, but I prefer this way. And once I ligate, I'll make sure that I hook the muscles again and then put one of the wing underneath the muscle. Once I'm done with that, again, I'll hook the other muscle and then I'll just, the implant is quite flexible. So you can just fold it and then you can put it underneath the other muscle. So these two are the steps which is different from AGV, where you have to isolate the muscle and then you put it the implant underneath the muscles. Rest is more or less the same. After putting the implant underneath the muscles, you have to anchor the plate. Normally we'll anchor around 8 to 10 millimeter from the limbus, and it has to be anchored with the help of a non-absorbable suture, which you can use a 9-0 nylon or a 10-0 proline. So we'll measure the distance with the help of calipers, and then you can use a 8-0 or 9-0 or a 10-0 proline. So make sure that it's a partial thickness clear incision that you're making with your needle. Because you may be operating on a patient who have a high myope, who have underwent multiple surgeries, the sclera may be a little thin. So you have to be very careful when you're taking a bite and anchor it. Both the, there are two holes in it, the implant. So you have to anchor both the So this is the second one which I'm anchoring. So once you're done with it, you can just gently rotate the knot so that it doesn't irritate the conjunctiva. You can gently rotate it and put it within the holes. So once you're done with the anchoring, you have to put the, cut the tube. So this is a very important step. You should know exactly how much of your tube that has to be there in the anterior chamber. Normally we aim for about 2 to 3 millimeter of tube in the anterior chamber. So when you measure it and cut it on top of the eye, the tube may be a little short, but when you keep it in, when the tube goes through the track, it may be a little longer one. So I usually aim for a 2 millimeter tube when I measure it on top of the cornea. Whereas when you put it in, it'll around 2 to 3 millimeter in the anterior chamber. And always make sure you cut the tube bevel up so that this prevents the corneal tube touch as well as prevents the iris from occluding the tube. Once you're done with the cutting of the tube, you have to put the, you have to enter the anterior chamber. I mean, depends on where you have to play, going to place the tube. If you are going to place the tube in the anterior chamber, I'll make an incision 2 mm from the limbus. And in case if I'm going to put the tube in the vitreous cavity, I'll make the incision 4 mm from the limbus. And we enter the anterior chamber to a 23 gauge needle. You have to use a 23 gauge needle mainly for the reason it snugly fits the tube and there is no peritubular leak in the initial postoperative period. So as you can see, in this patient, I'm putting the tube in the anterior chamber. So I'll measure 2 millimeter from the limbus and just make a groove with my 15 blade. And then I'll enter the anterior chamber with a 23 gauge needle. You have to put the tube in. You can use either a tube inserter or any other instrument which is good in your hands. I'll prefer a McPherson or a serrated forceps sometimes. As you can see, the tube is in the anterior chamber now. After putting the tube in the anterior chamber, you have to anchor the tube onto the sclera, which I'll generally do with the 10-0 nylon, which is a figure of 8 suture. This helps the tube in apposition with the sclera and prevents any lateral movement with the movement of the eyeball. So we can take horizontal sutures and make it a figure of 8. After anchoring the tube to the sclera, venting slits has to be done. Say we don't need any venting slit in case of an venting slit is mainly mandatory in patients who underwent a non-valved implants because there won't be any filtration that is happening till the tube is completely opened up. So for you to have an initial post-op IOP control, you need to have venting slits. This I'm showing it separately mainly because to make yourself understand how venting slit works. Say what happens is, so with the help of, you will say after ligating the tube, so this is, I will, after ligating the tube, I'm checking that there's no fluid which is filtering. Now I'm just with the help of a 10-0 nylon needle, I'm just going in and coming out through and through into the tube. I'm making 3 holes. And again, I'm injecting balanced ulceration. Now you can see the fluid which is coming out of these holes. So this is mainly helps you to control IOP in the initial post-operative period. Since most of these patients are on high IOP, on AGM, any surgery will have some sort of inflammation which can have an IOP spike in the initial post-operative period. So this will take care of the intraocular pressure control, the initial part, maybe around 2 to 3 weeks. With more scarring and fibrosis happens, this holes will be automatically will be closed. And once you're done with that, you can have to cover the tube. I prefer covering the tube with the patch graft. You can use either a scleral or a corneal patch graft, which is available. And you have to cut it to an adequate length, whatever required to cover both horizontally as well as the sides of the tube. And I'll suture it with a 10-0 nylon. Either you can suture both the, can use the anchor for, all the 4 sides separately, or you can use a palm book suture where you can take a horizontal sort of mattress sutures and you can anchor the patch graft on top of the tube. So this is a very important step as this will prevent any tube exposure in the post-operative period. Some may also use glue, but the problem with the glue is in case if you're using a venting slit, then glue will not help you out because for glue to completely stick, you need dry area. Whereas if there's a venting slit, there will be fluid which is filtering out. So your glue will not help you out. So in case you're planning a venting slit, better avoid glue and you can go for your sutures. And once I'm done with that, I have to close the conjunctiva. We use an 8-0 vicryl to close the conjunctiva. I'll take generally 2 wing sutures similar to how we close a trap part. The 2 horizontal wing sutures on either side. Once I'm done with that, I'll close the extra the extension part with the help of the same 8-0 vicryl suture and I'll put a continuous suture. So once I'm done with the closure of the wing sutures and I'm doing a continuous suture of the extension I have done. So I just sum up all these steps. So you have to put a nice traction suture so that because it needs more exposure and you have to put the implant underneath the muscles. So traction is very, very important. And you need a large conjunctival peritomy compared to an AGV minimum of 2 to 3 clock hours so that your exposure is very good. And you need to isolate the muscles, 2 adjacent muscles, depending upon the quadrant that you choose and check the patency of the implant tube and then ligate the tube. And once you're done with that, you can put the implant underneath the muscles and anchor the plate onto the sclera with the help of 9-0 nylon or tenoprolene and cut the tube to adequate length. Make sure it is bevel up and enter the anterior chamber with the help of 23 gauge needle. Put the tube into the anterior chamber and then anchor the tube onto the sclera. Cover the tube with the help of a patch graft and then you can close the conjunctiva with a vicryl suture. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Prem. Very good presentation. Thanks for the very detailed presentation. There's one question. By the time you take off your, stop sharing your screen. I share my screen. Maybe you could take this question. There's a question which Dr. Bindu is asking for patch graft cornea and MK media. After how many days can we use it? What is the maximum limit? She wants to know if Dr. Sushmita, Dr. Sirisha would also chip in. That'll be very helpful.
So we usually use glycerin-preserved sclera, but I would think in an MK medium, it's, if it's preserved, because this is not for corneal clarity, so I'm sure we could use it much longer than for an OPK, because you're not bothered about the clarity. Where glycerin-preserved is concerned, they might be there for days or weeks sometimes, and as long as it's sterile and it's you're careful about it, I don't think it should matter.
Yeah, agree. So there's no time limit as such. If so, for optical purposes, it's usually 7 days.
Yeah.
But non-optical purposes, it can be used longer.
Ganesh Raman, sir, your voice is not audible, sir.
You have to unmute, sir.
Unmute and please unmute and talk, sir.
Okay. Can you hear me now? Yeah.
Yes, sir. We can hear you, sir.
Okay. Thank you. There's a lot of discussion on patchless RD, and there was a lot of demand from delegates to, you know, cover the topic on patchless RD. So I'm talking RD implantation, and recent publications from Madurai, Aravind Eye Hospital Madurai, by Dr. George has come out, which gives a lot of strength to this concept. So the advantage of the patchless RD is that we use a scleral tunnel, which is universally practiced, and the long section of a tube is covered, and you have very good snug fit of the tube. You have very low profile of the implant. There is no movement of the tube and less chance of erosion. If you want to cut the suture ligature early, you have visibility of the suture ligature, and you could do argon laser suture ligature early. You don't have to wait for 28 or 42 days for the suture to automatically come off, especially if you haven't given venting slits, as Dr. Prem has shown. And this is something which we do. We monitor the tube position easily by ASOCT, especially if you have a swept source OCT. I'll show you some of the videos. And this is very useful in places where patch graft is not available or accessible. And also, prion disease are avoided. If you anybody is interested, they could go through this BGO article, which came out in 2002. So patchless glaucoma surgery is not something new. It's been described by Olila a long time back, and Dr. Oscar Donado from Mexico has published in IJO about it. And there's a group from Turkey which also practices this. And Dr. George Putran's article, which I'll be alluding to, has shown in adults as well as young children the benefits of doing a patchless implant. So the technique which I usually practice is something like this. So we make a 4 millimeter tunnel just about 4 millimeters from the limbus. So you have a total 8 millimeter tunnel, and half of it is a tunnel, half of it is a track. So the tunnel is made using a crescent blade, and this length is the tunnel, and you use a normal crescent to bring out. Make the tunnel, and then after that you use a 23 gauge needle to make a track at the distal end, so that enters into the anterior chamber. And once you have done that, you put the tube in through the tunnel. As you can see here, it has come out, and after that you insert the tube into the track, so the tube goes through and through within the sclera. That's about 8 millimeters, and then you can use infinity knots to secure the tube. So I'll just show you a video of it. So usually I would use a limbus-based flap, and to make the tunnel, it's very important that the tube doesn't come in the way. So I put the tube behind, between the sclera and the plate. And once it's there, make two grooves parallel to each other. And about 8 millimeters away is the first groove, and then about 4 millimeters away is the second groove. And use a crescent. So if you see the heel of the crescent, that should not abrade the tube. So the tube is kept away. The heel of the crescent, the sharp edge should not touch the or abrade the tube. It may damage the tube and you may have a leak postoperatively. And once you come to the distal portion of the tunnel, use a 15 number blade to lift out the sharp edge of the crescent. So it doesn't continue to go into the distal part of the tunnel. So you just want a segmented tunnel. And from that point onwards, you introduce a 23 gauge needle into the anterior chamber. So this is a little surgery which I'll show you how to lift a limbus base flap. And you already seen Dr. Premanand mention all the basic steps. So we'll go straight to the tunnel part of it. Once you have a limbus base flap, the advantage of this is you have access to the muscle area immediately. So you can hook the muscle directly. And suturing also becomes very easy. And once you suture, if it's a monocular patient, there are no stitches at the limbus which will hamper his vision the next day. So squinting of eyes, patients are really comfortable. They can walk home, and that's the advantage. And other advantages, you can access to the subtenens area very quickly. So if you want to give anesthesia, you can give it immediately. Like for example, here I'm giving local anesthesia, supplementing the subtenens anesthesia. With the subtenens anesthesia, peribal was given outside in the block room. And once you have the muscles, you can isolated the muscles, you can dissect anteriorly. And after testing the tube, you can, sometimes one suture is not sufficient. I mean, it wasn't done properly. So there was a leak. So you have to abandon that and apply one more suture and ligate. So there was a query in the question Q&A whether it is 60 or 80 vehicle. Actually, it's 60 or 70 vehicle, depending on when you expect the tube to be opened up. And once you have placed the implant inside, so everything's happening through a small pocket incision in the conjunctiva. Some of the surgeons, you can even roll it and keep it inside, especially if you have a smaller implant, you can just roll it and keep it. It's known as a taco technique. And you have sutured the plate. So we'll go forward. And again, this is, we are keeping the tube. Between the sclera and the plate, and that's a little bit of gentle cautery, and here comes the scleral tunnel. And once you have made the tunnel, you have to have a 15 number blade so that you lift up the leading edge of the blade so it doesn't go into the anterior, more anterior, or create a sort of a false passage, which will be a little broader than your needle track. So the snug fit may be lost. And from here, you insert the needle, which is a 23 gauge preferably, but if you're not able to get 23, you can use a 24 gauge as well. Sometimes we are finding a difficulty to procure 23 gauge nowadays, so we are using 24 gauge, and that's in the anterior chamber. You can see there's a bleb already there, so it's a refractory glaucoma. After bleb needling, planning this procedure, and about 2.5 millimeters length you can insert, and the tube goes into the tunnel and it goes into the track as well. So once it goes into the track, and then you can use infinity sutures to anchor the device plate as well as the tube in place. So this is another technique. If you want to do it infranasally, you have the same methodology. The advantage here is that the tunnel doesn't have to be from down to up. It can be from up to down because it's a tunnel, finally. Sort of easier to do, mainly because you have better visibility. And the same principle is used. And then once you are there, you can see this is the track being made. It comes into the anterior chamber. This is a pseudophakic eye with scarred conjunctiva superiorly, so we are going in inferiorly. And once you are there, you can take out the tube which is between the plate and the sclera and trim it, and then draw it through the tunnel. You can either push it or you can even pull it out. You can take the MacPherson through the tunnel and bring it out. And as soon as it comes out, just push it into the track which is already made. And as you push it in, you can see it in the anterior chamber, coming into the anterior chamber, and the length of the tube will get shortened near the plate. And then you suturing is same as what has been described previously. An infinity suture, and then anchor the plate tube to the sclera so that the profile is kept very low. So this is Dr. George's article in which they compared adult eyes and pediatric eyes with patch graft and without patch graft. So in both adults and pediatric eyes, tube exposure was more common in patch graft eyes. And so we were very perplexed as to why this should be. This is sort of, and in the IOP range with and without patch graft, there's no difference. So you can see that both works very well. Plus you have the added advantage of having less tube exposure. The previous, I mentioned Dr. Olila's technique. This is how it is. If you are not comfortable using a track in the head, you can make a scleral flap and then also place the tube. So the advantage of this technique is either if you want to keep it in the antechamber, you can do that, or if you want to place in the sulcus, you can just dip a little bit lower and put the tube in the sulcus. So because you have far better exposure. And from here, you have two scleral tunnels, one behind the other. And then this is a very brief report. Number of cases, only 38. And there was one tube erosion in this technique, whereas the conventional technique with the patch graft had 3 of 35 eyes with tube erosion. And Dr. Oscar study, which was published in IGO in 2010 using AGV, showed that without patch, they had no extrusion rates. So this is a small video to show you how you can use a swept source OCT to look at the tube, which is in the sclera, because swept source OCT has a much better penetration of the sclera. You can see that you can track the tube to some length. You cannot see the whole length, and you can see the patency of the tube. So it shows that sclera doesn't really compress off the cost of the tube. You can also take a single images and do your analysis. If you want to measure the thickness of the sclera over the tube, you could do that. And this is a patient who had a combined procedure which did not go well, as you can see from the image. And she had a tube implantation. So you can analyze using OCT the position of the tube and the patency. And this is an eye syndrome patient who had a tube in the sulcus. So his 2 months post-op visit was today. So this is what we scanned, and you can see the tube. He's got a very low cornea count, about 700 cell density count. And we placed it in the sulcus. So how you place it in the sulcus is you make a vertical nick near the limbus and do an iridectomy, and then bring in the tube through the iridectomy so that it's present. You can see the tip of the tube in the sulcus in the PI, and it should not be occluded by any other material like iris or the zonules. So it should be visible. And we scan the image. You can see that it goes really low, and you have very thick sclera above that. That means it's driven very low, and very you have a very less thickness of sclera beneath the tube. So how do you close conjunctival limbus based conjunctival surgery? So the technique which we use is the continuous key pattern. You can also have the running pattern, but you must understand there can be a little bit of lateral shift of the conjunctiva, or you can have the loop lock technique in which you can have a little bit of cheese wiring. So we use a continuous key pattern mainly because it's heal faster, opposition is better, and there is no lateral shift. So to do that, we use it for conjunctival glaucoma in which limbus based conjunctival flap is also made. And you use a 8-0 vicryl, and then something like a subcuticular method of drawing the suture. And you start off from one end. Since it's a small pocket incision, you don't have You start off from one end, and but the important thing is don't override the conjunctiva. So this loop should not go, it should go back and forth rather than right over the incisions. So this is a little laborious, but if you are able to make a small incision, it helps a lot because you can suture very fast, and there are no sutures present in the limbus. So if you are operating on a monocular patient, like I said Mitch before, it helps a lot in suturing the conjunctiva. And once you are at the end of it, you pull both the sutures together, you find that the conjunctiva is nicely opposed. And you shouldn't purse string it. You shouldn't pull it tight so that it causes a purse string, but you should just leave it opposed and then tighten the loop the knots and tighten the suture. If you purse string it, there is a little bit of crush injury. Once you have tightened it, you pull the sutures apart so that the conjunctiva sort of spreads out. Yeah. So I'll stop here. Thank you very much for a patient listening.
Your voice is muted, Ganesh.
Please unmute, sir.
Thank you. I think we have a lot of questions. I think we'll go ahead with the program, and then we'll have a panel discussion at the end. I would now invite Dr. Sirisha Sindhil to give her talk on complications of RD, prevention and management.
Thank you, Ganesh, and thank you to the Oral Lab for the invitation and for the wonderful program. So, implant surgery is generally a choice in those eyes where the conjunctiva is scarred and multiple previous procedures have been done, and most often we will not be able to do any kind of a conventional incisional surgery. So, to begin with, these are difficult eyes. And majority of the time, they do have some problem or the other, either in the conjunctiva or in the anterior chamber, and we have to deal with that. We can't emphasize more on planning the surgery and the technique very well, because meticulous surgery will definitely help to prevent complications, and I think that should be the priority. Choose an appropriate type of implant, choose appropriate size of implant. Location of the implant is something that we will pre-plan, not sit on the table, look at the eye and decide whether we want to do it supratemporally or infranasally. I think we need to plan it. If most often we have seen the patient prior, in case we haven't seen the patient prior and that's been scheduled in your list, it still is mandatory for you to examine the patient in the operation theater before you take it up for surgery, so that you can plan better. And if there are additional instrumentation that you require or additional material that you require for surgery, that should be procured and kept ready. And of course, positioning of the tube is something that is also very, very important. So, like I said, I would emphasize again that planning the surgery is the first step to preventing complications. And we plan the surgery based on multiple things like the size of the eyeball, mobility of the conjunctiva, how is it scarred, thickness of the sclera, corneal clarity, depth of the anterior chamber, presence of peripheral anterior synechiae, whether the patient is phakic, aphakic, or pseudophakic, or how is the vitreous in the anterior, is the vitreous in the anterior chamber present, or in the anterior vitreous phase, if we have to plan to place a sulcus tube or a pars plana tube. When we discuss about complications, I think they are primarily related to the intraocular pressure and the implant. So because unlike the trabeculectomy, where it's just the hypotony that you're worried about or high pressure that you're worried about, with drainage implants, we also have to worry about the huge hardware that is sitting there, either the tube in the anterior chamber or a long tube in the subconjunctival space or a plate that is sitting right there in the posterior subconjunctival space. So just to start off the discussion, we looked at the outcomes of ADI and AGV in our own cohort, mostly the children. Most of the complications are almost similar between ADI and AG. AGV, except that the choroidal detachment that happened in the early postoperative period, if you look at the numbers, which are almost similar between AGV and RD group, but CD that was there for a longer time, it took longer to resolve, or a delayed hypotony with the development of a cataract with two complications that were very unique to the RD group. So hypotony happens because of the dissolution of ligature that we use for a non-valved implant. When does it occur? It occurs like what Prem was telling, depending upon whether you're using a 7-0 absorbable suture or a 6-0 absorbable suture. It can happen anytime between 4th to 6th week. So between 4th to 10th week, if we have to also take into consideration the other type of sutures that I use, three types of complications that I have commonly encountered, and I'm sure this is something that most of you have seen as well. It is related to choroidal detachment because of hypotony, excess inflammation that happens around the tube as well as in the anterior chamber, as well as a peculiar kind of a complication that is hypotony related to the later time after the ligature has opened up, and especially in children, the development of cataract as well. How do we prevent it? So there are multiple things that we can do. So if we say that it's the ligature dissolution of the ligature that is responsible for this problem, majority of the people in the West, especially in the UK, they use something called as a tube stenting or a supramid suture, which is a 3-0 nylon suture, which is a different variety. We don't have it in India. That's a transparent kind of a nylon. It's a braided one in the center and a smooth one on the top. That is used to stent the tube, and also the tube ligature is placed. So what happens when the ligature opens up? The tube is still stented with this nylon suture. And because it is braided in the center, it also, because of the capillary action, allows some amount of fluid to drain through. A very interesting fact that I came to know when I was visiting them and when I was asking, how do you deal with the hypotony related problems? They said they used to have close to 10% of the people with hypotony, especially when the ligature opened up. And after adding the Supramid, they realized that the risk of complications or the rate of complication has come down to just 1%. From 10% to 1% is a huge decrease. I think that is a very, very important shift. So we don't have the Supramid in our country yet, but I'm sure it will be available sometime. So that is one thing. The other things that people use are also 3-0, the typical 3-0 nylon that we have, which is a non-braided one, or a proline suture, or some people also use an intracameral stenting or ligation. And then the intracameral ligation that they normally use a proline suture with, at a staged decrease in the ligature opening is what they are looking at. So once the absorbable suture opens up, the non-absorbable is still present. And that can be, if it's a supramid, it can be removed by a conjunctival nick based on how the pressures behave in the postoperative period. That could be 3rd month, 4th month, sometimes 6th month. And I also hear that about 10% of the patients, they don't have to remove the intraluminal stenting, which means that if these patients did not have intraluminal stenting, all of them would definitely have had a hypotony. So this is a very, very important complication, and that is something that we need to prevent. Apart from that, we also have to understand, and I said this problem can happen in a small percentage of patients, several of them don't have it. So that's something that we all have to remember. And post-operative assessment is extremely important. So this is a picture that shows the ligature that is visible through here, the ridge of the implant, and there is no fluid around the implant plate. When the ligature opens up, you see that it's a beautiful diffuse bleb. That it's important for you to examine the depth of the anterior chamber, intraocular pressure, as well as how the bleb looks like. But especially in children or in patients who are not very cooperative, or in those patients who do not come back for a follow-up, I think at least the local treating doctor should be able to do this for us. Apart from anterior segment photograph and the intraocular pressure, if they can also do a B-scan ultrasonography, it gives us a lot of information about the fluid around the plate, plus if they have a minimal amount of choroidal detachment, or sometimes we don't see a CD, but we see a very thickened choroid. That also tells you thickened choroid is an indication to say that there is hypotony, but these eyes generally tend to have a prolonged inflammation in the post-operative period, which means that we may need to treat them with the topical steroids for a longer time than we normally do. when do we intervene surgically? If they have, there are kissing choroidals or there is a suprachoroidal hemorrhage, then of course we need to, depending on how things are and how serious it is and how much of the choroidal adhesions are there and is it responding to initial medical treatment or not, we decide on to intervene. What do we do if we have to intervene? Apart from, I will show you a couple of videos. Apart from if it is a huge choroidal detachment, not just draining the choroids. This is something that I've heard again and again. So if you have a shallow anterior chamber and if you have a choroidal effusion, many people actually take it up surgically to go and reform the anterior chamber with viscoelastic. Remember, if your tube is patent, the viscoelastic that you're placing in the eye takes less than a few hours for it to disappear, even if it means heal on GV or whatever you're talking about. So please don't do that. Just don't leave viscoelastic in the anterior chamber, and that is not going to take care of the problem. Your intention is to make sure that the tube is re-ligated again. That could be with an absorbable suture that you have used earlier, that is a 6-0 Vicryl, or you can use a permanent ligature with the help of an 80-bond suture, or there is another technique that we use. We use a 3-0 nylon suture to stent the tube. So whatever you do, either an ab interna technique or an ab externa technique, intraluminal stenting, whatever you do, if you have such a serious complication and if you are intervening, we might as well ligate the tube. And if you have an extensive choroidal detachment, you can drain that as well. So this is an 8-year-old child with glaucoma and pseudophakia. Both the children, this boy as well as his elder sister, both of them had congenital cataract. And this child had developed a serious problem. You can see the lens. Almost there is an aniridia kind of a picture. You can actually see the brownish hue because of extensive choroidal detachment that developed 7 weeks post Adi, and he came to the emergency with a drop in intraocular pressure and drop in vision. At 6th week, I had seen him. His pressures were 10 and 12. Beautiful eye. Everything was so good, and I was very happy for him. But he came back a child. You know, it's very difficult to say why it happened. It could be possible that he was jumping around. Whatever is the reason, he's had a massive choroidal detachment and the hand motions vision and came to us. So this is a technique that I used to, so he had a large CD, but we did not want to drain it because in children generally, you know, it was not a kissing choroidal. It was a large mound on the temporal side and smaller ones on the other side. So we just went, opened up the conjunctiva just a little bit, re-ligated the tube with 6-0 Vicryl, posterior end of the patch graft, and then it's a tiny opening. So closed the conjunctiva back again with the same Vicryl suture. So this way, this child, after the intervention, in about 1 week's time, he beautifully resolved, because the CD completely resolved. And by about 2 months, his vision came back to what it was. He's amblyopic in that eye. Vision has come back to what it was before, IOP 13 with no anti-glaucoma medications. This was not a very fortunate patient that way. Pseudo exfoliation, very old gentleman, close to 80 years, underwent an Adi. That was because of multiple problems that he had before and multiple surgeries that failed in a very short period. So 6 weeks after the surgery, when the ligature opened up, again for him, the day when he came back for a review at the 6th week, he actually didn't have this problem. A couple of days later, he presented to the emergency with a decrease in intraocular pressure, very shallow anterior chamber, and a tube corneal touch. So this gentleman had a huge choroidal detachment. Although he didn't have a kissing choroidal, because he was an elderly person, and it's going to take a very long time for the CE to resolve, we decided to do a choroidal drainage as well. So you can see the amount of fluid that is draining out of the huge choroidal fluid that came out. So this is a 3-0 nylon that I'm using to stent the tube from the back and also ligate the tube again. So this ligature is something, so initially I didn't know whether it will occlude completely or not, hence I did a double closure, but it's possible some people just use the stenting and they don't ligate the tube with a Vicryl, but I definitely don't want to take any chance, so I do a double ligature, a double closure. And this patient again, 6 weeks later, his vision came back to what it was before, and intraocular pressure so beautifully maintained, now only on anti-glaucoma medication. Remember, this patient has a tube which was stented with a non-absorbable suture, which means that if I had not stented the tube and just re-ligated it with Vicryl, it's possible that he would have gone into hypotony again. So this was a very peculiar complication that I saw, an infranasal Adi that was done in a patient who had multiple previous procedures, and he has a supratemporal AGV as well. So 3 weeks post-operative period, if you see, this is the anterior conjunctival line, which is healed. Posteriorly, where the ligature is placed, that Vicryl kind of was rubbing on the conjunctiva and that had kind of eroded. if you see, I can stain it with a cobalt blue light. You can see a minimal staining here, but obviously there was no leak because the tube is completely ligated. And I was expecting that this patient may have problem, but since it was third week and another 3 weeks, I thought it should conjunctivalize, epithelize in that area and may not have a problem. He went back to his native place and a local doctor there, one of our friends, was following up. And this gentleman, as was expected, had a leak when the ligature opened up. Although a very, very minimal leak, this is not something that you will take lightly, especially in a non-barred implant, because of the problems that we have of not a very thick bleb wall that is formed. And this is going to take it. And the only bleb wall resistance is the one that is there. And so if you have any breach in the conjunctiva, any breach in the capsule, you will obviously have a serious problem. So this patient was taken up and the conjunctiva was resutured. And this is the 3 month post-operative picture with the tube in the sulcus, very deep anterior chamber, pressures of 16 on no medications and beautifully healed conjunctiva. After that incident, what I do is I also use a patch graft, but I make sure that, so most often when we make the knot, usually we try to push it towards the lateral side and not jutting over the tube, but sometimes it's not possible. So what I do is I use the patch graft to cover even the posterior vicryl. The ligature, the tube ligature that I've used, I just don't want to take a chance of kind of a conjunctival expo. Usually posterior conjunctiva has thick tenons. This doesn't happen. In the many, the huge number of cases that we have done, this is the first time I've seen such a complication. This is a rare complication, but I think it's very important to mention this, especially in children. The reason why we see a lot of these problems in children and the reason why we need to know this also is because, you know, AGV or any valved implant in kids, they have a lot of problem because of the thick fibrotic capsule that they develop. And most often a non-valved implant is something that is good for them in the long run for the pressure control. But having said that, these are some complications that we need to worry about and we need to know how to handle it. So in children, inflammation is more, and because of hypotony and because of decrease in the aqueous secretion or increase in the aqueous outflow, these children develop a lot of inflammation. And one of the things that happen, just like in your any ischemic eye or any eye that is hypotonous, we know that it develops a cataract. So that way they develop a cataract. And if we see this child again was operated for a cataract, even post-operatively had severe inflammation in the anterior chamber. So what we have learned is that these eyes are known to have inflammation, but when managed appropriately, it completely resolved and the child is doing really well. So, and or if you have a very dense cataract and you know that there is no situation where you'll be able to place a intraocular lens because of the corneal problem with the corneal clarity and things like that, do a complete lensectomy. Do not leave behind a capsular margin thinking that we will be able to place a secondary IOL at a later date, because that can lead to a lot of problem of the remnant lenticular material that is there or the capsular fibers that are there. That can actually lead to a lot of inflammation. In my experience, these eyes used to develop severe inflammation and they did go back into hypotony again. So I would prefer doing that. Another problem that I have seen and that I'm sure many of the colleagues also have shared is this inflammatory membrane around the tube. This again does not happen in the immediate post-operative period, immediately after the ligature opens up, but this happens later, usually by about 5th to 6th month. And when I went back and reviewed my own patients as to why this happened, it's possible that we were trying to taper off the steroids a little faster than what we should be. At least that is my impression I can hear from the other panelists. This is again a very rare complication that I saw in an adult patient, where you see these membranes that are there in the anterior chamber, huge amount. In fact, I got really worried when I saw this. I thought it was kind of an endogenous endophthalmitis. And I don't know why this inflammation was like that. This is the picture when the tube was done before the ligature opened up. And you see the second, third, and the fourth picture that after the ligature opened up, despite this was a post-DSEC patient. Patient was on a high-dose steroids, but still he did have this kind of an inflammation. But it did come down after some time, but you know, because of the severe inflammation that he had, the graft started decompensating as well. So now what I understand and what I do to prevent this problem is that steroids are stepped up when the ligature opens up. That is by about six to eight times. And I taper them in a 2 weekly fashion until 3 times. And I, in vulnerable patients, I tend to taper after 3 times on a monthly basis. And cyclopegics, of course, are given in the postoperative period. When I say postoperative period, I'm talking about after the ligature opens up. And sometimes the membrane is so thick that this was a child who had a very thick membrane in the graft host junction. The tube was engulfed and the pressures shot up. Instead of planning a repeat intervention, we have to understand why this happened. You can see that the tube is completely stuck to the membrane and that had to be surgically removed. It had to be excised, and you know there is a problem that we may also destroy or damage the endothelium, and the, you can see that decimates had actually come out because it was strongly adherent. Unfortunately, we could place the air bubble, push it back, and then did a couple of venting incisions on the cornea to prevent the detachment of the decimates in this patient, and the child also did well after the surgery. Anterior bleb or plate migration is extremely rare complication, but I've seen it in a couple of patients, either referred or one or two of our patients that we have seen in our institute as well. This happens if the wing of the plate is slipped from under the rectus muscle, or sometimes this is very rare, but I've also read about this, that it can sometimes disinsert the muscle belly or the tendon, and it can migrate anteriorly. So that is something that is very, very scary. This was a child of mine, post-traumatic eye, 12-year-old, aphakic, multiple vitreoretinal surgeries. You can understand by looking at the eye, what a difficult eye it was. So pars plana tube was placed. Early post-op, he was doing well. This was actually, six weeks or 8 weeks post-op. As time went by, the scleral patch graft started thinning and there was ballooning that was happening in the anterior part of the conjunctiva. And you see the implant plate is also trying to migrate anteriorly. This child, we have not intervened yet because the parents were not keen on having a surgery done. But it's a very, very scary situation. You never know with an implant like this what kind of a problem you will have. So how can you prevent that? Make sure that you are isolating the muscle really well, and the whatever adhesions that are there underneath that, all the tenons adhesions have to be cleared with the help of two hooks that you use, and make sure that you're placing it very well, placing the two wings very well under the recti muscle. One small tip I just wanted to share, you see these blood vessels going obliquely towards the muscle. So sometimes in the initial stages, when we start doing the adi, we may have difficulty in identifying the muscles. One of the indication here is if you trace this blood vessel and go posteriorly, it actually reaches the root of the muscle tendon. Tube block is another rare problem. So I'm not typically talking about any tube-related, plate-related problems that are common for both AGV and ADI, but I thought I'll cover those that are pertaining to ADI, and hence I have purposefully excluded all of that. So this patient had a tube block. So you can try and prevent that, especially, you know, if the patient has a lot of synechiae in the anterior chamber or a very shallow anterior chamber. This is an aphake with multiple peripheral anterior synechiae. So this is a technique like what Dr. Ganesh also had mentioned. You can do a small hole in the iris, a peephole like thing, which Sushmita also has described and published. Or you can place it in the sulcus if the pupil is large enough. So you can try and bring the tube into the anterior chamber. When you know that it's going to block, you would rather prevent it by, making surgically itself, you're trying to avoid that by bringing it into the anterior chamber. Scarred conjunctiva and things like that, we need to be careful. So I'm not going into the details here, but a couple of things about conjunctival closure, especially because the implant plate is large, and sometimes the location of the surgery is also in a place where at least a minimal amount of conjunctival mobility is there. This was a patient of mine. Once I finished the surgery, it was so difficult to close the conjunctiva, and despite all efforts, there was a small little hole in the conjunctiva. So if you have a situation like that, don't just suture the conjunctiva that is torn again and again. So I'm suturing the conjunctiva to the underlying scleral patch graft and then covered it with an amniotic membrane, and that will help it to heal very well. Of course, you can use postoperative doxycycline and things like that, but that can prevent, because like I said, conjunctival defect is something in the first few postoperative weeks you will not have a problem, but when the ligature is about to open up, if the conjunctiva is not healed well, you can have serious complications. Tube ligature has to be done completely to prevent hypotony. So ligature can be done externally, like what Prem and Ganesh had shown, but I generally tend to ligate it once the implant plate is fixed. So this was a patient of mine. I was actually describing this to a fellow of mine, and I said, you have to be very careful when you're ligating it. If you're doing it loosely, then the tube won't occlude. If you're doing it very tightly, it may break, and I don't know what happened, but it just broke. And this is a terrible thing to happen. We need to be careful. So one of the things that can avoid doing this is to fixate the tube with the posterior part. If you do that, the tube is not mobile, and you will be able to nicely go and ligate it posterior to this. And I do two ligatures. So one is posterior to that. Another one is in the middle of that box that we make. So that will help it to, it's not mobile, so it's kind of easy to ligate. Tube fenestrations are definitely very important, but when you are doing a fenestration, we also have to be very, very sure that where we are doing it and two or three slits that we give. I'll just show you a patient of mine where I did a slit, and then after that, there was too much of a fluid that was flowing out, and I thought that's okay. Once I put the patch graft, things should be all right. But once I closed the conjunctiva, I realized that the globe was very, very hypotenous. Then I went, reopened the scleral patch graft and re-ligated it once anterior to that. So we need to be very careful. So while fenestrations generally don't cause a problem, it depends upon how large a fenestration you have made and how the patient's eye is behaving. So if you have any clue intraoperatively, take it. Don't take it lightly and say, it's okay, I think it should be all right, or I'll just put visco in the anterior chamber and things should be okay. I think it's better to prevent it rather than feel sorry about it later. One question that is commonly asked, I thought I'll just put it up because I'm talking about complication. Very elderly patients, older than 80 years, patients with pseudo exfoliation, neovascular glaucoma, especially those with post-transscleral cyclophotocoagulation, and very one-eyed patients with very small central island of vision. These are some of my contraindications for ADI because they tend to have more complications than the others. And hence, I would avoid doing a non-valved implant, but the rest of them are all definite indications for a non-valved implant. So to summarize, ADI is a big boon in the management of refractory glaucoma, no question about it. Whether it's the IOP control or the cost, it's been a huge advantage for us. Meticulous surgery with modifications, we have to choose as appropriate. Anticipate problems and prevent them. That's the best way to have a peaceful post-operative course. And in case it happens, identify it. And I think we should be shrewd enough to know how these eyes are going to behave and treat them appropriately and early. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Dr. Sirisha. A wonderful lecture. We have a lot of questions piling up. So what we'll do is we'll go ahead with Dr. Sushmita's talk. And then some of the questions I and Prem have been covering. But the major ones, I want your opinion on the question. So we'll have a small panel discussion after. So I request Dr. Sushmita to speak to us on AG versus RD, which one to choose when.
Yeah. Thank you, Dr. Ganesh, and thank you for the invitation. And it's been a lovely session so far. So we've heard the putting it in, we've heard the complications. So we'll just in the next couple of minutes see how the AGV and Barweld compare, because that is the real prototype design, and preliminary data of the small pilot RCT that we did, and a bit about how I would choose which. So just to reiterate that there have been two very large multicentric prospective randomized control trials on the AGV and the Barweld. One was the ABV, the Ahmed-Barweld comparison, and one was the Ahmed versus Barweld, the AVB. And we are happy that we've had 5-year pool data from both studies, so it saves us time from having to read both. So totally, there are 514 patients in both these large studies, 267 Ahmed and 247 Barweld. So the largely in a nutshell, the conclusions are that the Barweld group had a lower failure rate, a lower rate of additional surgery required, lower mean IOP and fewer medications. But the caveat of the lower IOP was also that the Barweld had a higher risk of hypotony. So now talking about the ADI with this background, we do have a sizable literature from our center at PGI, from Hyderabad, from Dr. Sirisha, and of course, Dr. George himself from Madurai. And in a nutshell, all our pooled data seem to suggest that the ADI is safe and effective in both children as well as adults. And compared to the AGV, the ADI has a better IOP control, lesser anti-glaucoma medications required, and comparable complications. So just let's do an overview of what we have for the ADI. So this is literature from PGI where we looked at both early and late. So this was the randomized controlled study of a thesis with Dr. Pandav. This was a long-term outcome of the ADI, a three-year follow-up data. And this was a short term of the Aurolab versus of the ADI versus AGV. These were all adults. So the intraocular pressure was lower in the ADI. The anti-glaucoma medications was lower. But the late hypotony, the little cause of worry, was 3.4% in ADI versus 0.6% in the AGV. And this is up to 2 to 3 years later. And the surgical interventions required were much more in the AGV. And most of them were relating to a very thick fibrous capsule form, which we tried to cut and negate, where the ADI, it was really minimal, and the additional problems required were less. And then the overall success was about 58% in the AGV and 73% in the ADI, so that was a little more. Coming to Hyderabad, in adults, Dr. Vanita Patakrai showed both procedures are effective in reduction. This was a retrospective analysis. And the overall success was higher in the ADI again, and the IOP and the number of AGM required was significantly lower. Coming to children, this in fact in the BJO was the first study in children, in fact the first study of the ADI that was published from our center again. 2 years we followed up these children prospectively, and there was good efficacy, and we were really happy at the cost coming down, because we know how poor these children usually are when they come to us. So then Dr. George looked at their children and followed them up a little longer and realized that, yes, there were good results till 2 years, and then the success seemed to wane a little bit. So that's something to keep in mind, because with children, you know, you have a lifetime to hold their hands for. And then Dr. Sirisha published hers in the Ophthalmology Glaucoma, and they compared a comparison of the ADI and AGV in children. Well, they reported that qualified success at 1 and 3 years was similar. Complete success, the ADI was better. Of course, the hypertensive phase was lesser with the ADI, which is so important in younger patients, as we've seen, and complications they reported were similar. So let's understand the basic fundamentals of valved and non-valved implants. Now, the tube offers no resistance to the outflow. That's something to understand. Putting in a tube means you are putting in a conduit for the aqueous to come out. For early IOP control, what is it that you require? Whether there's a presence or there's an absence of a valve. Valve devices provide more immediate IOP control, and that's why you have a lower rate of hypotony, simply because there is a valve to stop the flow out of the tube. Non-valve devices have to be occluded with either a ligature or a stent, as Dr. Sirisha just showed, and the post-operative IOP is unchanged. So that's why they usually require some sort of anti-glaucoma medication, at least until the capsule is formed and the tube has some resistance to flow. And therefore, people who are not tolerant of anti-glaucoma medications do not tolerate or do not like the ADI very much. Long-term IOP control is dependent upon the surface area, largely. And that is what determines the bleb size. It's what determines the tissue response to the implant. And it also determines the thickness of the fibrous capsule. So generally, if you have a smaller plate or a smaller surface area, your long-term IOP control is going to be lesser. Whereas for larger ones, it'll be more, which is what led to double plate multinos, because they wanted a larger surface area for better IOP control. And this in some way would explain why the ADI long-term in most studies, and the Barwell for that matter, has shown up to be a much better long-term intraocular pressure control. So once we understand that, you need to think about how do you choose. Now, this is a complex decision. It's not as though, let me get this or let me get that. Many factors would come into play. So over time, over the last 5 years or so that we've dabbled with both drainage implants, I'm just sharing some thoughts that have crystallized. One, since the non-valved implant has a larger surface area, you're likely to get lesser IOP, yes, but you are also likely to have a risk of hypotony. Valved implants, on the other hand, if you need the IOP to be lowered as soon as possible, or if they are diamox intolerant or other anti-glaucoma medications intolerant, patients at greatest risk of complications of hypotony, the high myopes, the uveitis. And why the uveitis? Simply because the ciliary body is already a little less optimal because of repeated inflammation. And then if you go and put in a non-valved implant, these are the eyes which are likely to go into hypotenuse. And the worst ones, for instance, in children are the ones with JIA. So for juvenile idiopathic arthritis, I'd be very wary of putting in an adi. The issue, of course, just does come up. There are times when I've actually cut the wings of the adi to reduce the surface area and yet keep it as a non-valved implant and ligate the tube and then implant it in. So which would we choose? Of course, in our setting at least, the major factor is cost. Right now, the AGV, if we really, really request them, they come down least to 17,000, but not lower than that. But it varies between 17 to 20,000 versus 4,500 for an adi. In a young patient, I found the adi to be a boon. So I'm just going to share this little video. This is a young girl, a 12-year-old, and you can see the fibrous encapsulation with an AGV. And this is what we used to do many times when we didn't have the adi. And not having this, this is almost as thick as a sclera. And sometimes it also insinuates into the valve of the AGV, into the tube of the AGV. And believe me, it was a real tussle to take this out. And you thought you'd done a good job, and 3 weeks later, 4 weeks later, it would bang, come right back. So probably it's due to a flat surface area, not so irregular, and a larger surface area. But the adi, we don't see these thick fibrous capsules any longer. When would I prefer the AGV? And that's also important because you need to choose it. If you have a pre-existing encerclage band or buckle, it's difficult to dissect under the muscles, as you can imagine, and place the adi in the presence of an encerclage. So I'll give you a couple of examples. So this one-eyed 14-year-old boy here, you can see this large buckle, and he had lost one eye to a blast injury, come from Kashmir actually. The other eye had had cataract surgery, then he had RD, then it recurred. So he had a buckle in place, and then he had a PPV, and then he had a silicone oil as well. With all this, his best corrected vision, this one-eyed boy was 624, but the intraocular pressure after all that was 44 millimeters on maximum medication. And he had no money left. So this was a time when Dr. George had been generous and given us some of the adis to implant, and I was so happy. And I said, okay, I'll put in an adi. And lo and behold, when I opened this up with all these multiple surgeries and blast and trauma and whatnot, it was a mess. So dissecting under the muscle and even getting to the muscle and all this tissue was very, very difficult. And you don't know what these fibers are. You don't know whether it's muscle or not. So finally, you do get through it. And somehow you need to negotiate under the muscle through that fibrosis and get that adi into place. It's not that it's not possible. It's just that it does get to be very, very difficult. So you can see that we are struggling with it, but it's under one muscle here. It's under the other there. And remember, this is over and above a buckle and a band. We did try to push it back. But in a child, remember, you don't want to be too aggressive in pushing it back because it'll be too close to the macula in that sense. Well, 3 months later, all was well. He's 12 millimeters. You can see that it's pretty much flat, the conjunctiva. And the tube is in place. The vision is what it was. So we're just hoping, and so far so good, and he's been all right 2-3 years later. Now I'm going to show you why I would choose an AGV if I could. Now this 56-year-old diabetic with the right eye TRD and PVR operated, but at hand motions. The left eye had PVR as well. He underwent a PPV with encerclage, with silicone oil, post-PPV intractable glaucoma. He's pseudophakic. His emulsified oil we sent back, it was removed twice. Nothing happened to the pressures. And with the extensively scarred conjunctiva, he also had 624 vision, but very, very high pressure. So you can see preoperatively, it's important to really look, pull the fornices down and look at the band and the buckle. And if you have large bands and buckle like that, you're a little concerned about putting it in adi. So in this patient, when I chose the AGV, I'll just in this short clip, demonstrate how easy it is. So you just dissect it out. Of course, that's a pain as well. So when you open up the capsule with that buckle there, in a minute, you can see the AGV just slides down. So what we do is we just push it over the buckle and then suture it to the posterior edge of the buckle. And there the tube comes in and that is that. The other thing, of course, you can do is use the fibrous capsule for instead of putting in a plate, and then suture the tube to that fibrous capsule and make it work as an implant. But for that, you have to have the buckle in one of the quadrants which you've chosen for the tube. And many times that may be possible and may not be. Right, so post-operatively, this is the tube, and you can see that all that manipulation, no matter what they did, here is emulsified silicone oil next morning again. But mercifully, just a small tip, when it's a silicone oil operated eye, it's a good idea to put the tube inferiorly, because this emulsified oil is not going to block your tube. It's going to go through, but it's going to cause a lot of fibrosis post-operatively, and you might have bad pressure control because of that. So to summarize, the Adi appears to be an effective low-cost GDD. Remember, we are just 3 or 5 years. Most of us don't have more than 5 years experience. So especially with children, you need to be a little cautious and you need to follow them up a little longer. Its flat surface area may reduce the incidence of raised pressures, and the larger surface area than Multino and AGV may mean more effective IOP control in the long term. But the, as I said, the long-term follow-up is still awaited. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Sushmita. Thank you for very much for that very lucid and very clear-cut advantages and disadvantage of using RD as well as AGV. Thank you very much. Now we can go on to the question-answer session. So if there's a question from Dr. Vahedian, if restrictive strabismus arises, the ophthalmologist should operate on muscles which are covering the plate. This causes violation of the capsule around the plate and shallow channel. Is there any solution? Have any of us experienced something like this, need for a muscle surgery after RD? Personally, I have not. I would request Dr. Sushmita and Dr. Sirisha to give their inputs.
No, not personally, but I would say that even if you have a restriction, I would logically operate on an unaffected muscle on the other side, either the other eye or the unaffected muscle on that side. So instead, if, for instance, if I had a lateral rectus restriction, I would rather do a medial rectus recession rather than try and fiddle around with that restricted muscle, or do the other eye, either of them.
Dr. Sirisha?
Yeah, so fortunately we haven't had, and I have one patient who's awaiting because of the lockdown, he did not come. But then that gentleman that I showed where the vicryl suture what was giving way through the conjunctiva, he actually to begin with had a strabismus because of the AGV. His AGV plate was huge, and then he maybe had a pre-existing phoria that had decompensated. But like Sushmita said, I would agree. So when I discussed with our squint specialist, they said the same thing, that we will not touch that eye because obviously the bleb and the capsule is very, very difficult to handle, and you don't want to touch that because the pressures are well controlled, otherwise fine. So you operate the muscles that have not been touched, the same eye as well as in the contralateral eye.
Prem, you would like to, you'll let give you inputs?
No, I agree, sir. No, nothing else to say.
Okay, there's one more question which says that difference between any experience with difluprid and prednisolone in the post-operative periods in adults as well as kids. Dr. Sirisha?
I haven't used it, but I think it's a good idea because we don't like to use difluprid because you know that the amount of IOP raise that it causes is really, really high. So like in severe hypotony cases, so when I say severe hypotony, the delayed hypotony that you see beyond 5 months, 6 months, 1 year, sometimes even at 1 year and 2 years, although it's rare, but when you see them, I think it's a good idea to give difluprid. But remember, majority of these patients, unless they are secondary glaucomas, may have a glaucoma, and that pressure control in the contralateral eye is also something that you need to worry about.
Yeah.
So be careful. You can use it. The answer to that is yes, but you need to really, really closely monitor the pressures.
Dr. Sushmita?
No, I've used difluprid in hypotony. It hasn't worked in even one of them. Okay. I've had to go back and do whatever logically you should do. I was hoping to use the raised pressure bit, but when you need the raised pressure, it doesn't raise it. So,
Prem, your take on that?
You're muted, Prem. Prem is muted.
Yeah, sorry, ma'am. Difluprednate has more chance of having high AOP, particularly in kids. So better to avoid in kids. Even in adults, even say when difluprednate was came, everybody used to say it's good for a post-cataract surgery because you can use it thrice a day and then you can stop it. But we came across a lot of patients with IOP spikes, so we are not using it. So I don't prefer a difluprednate over a prednisolone.
There is one question which says, typical post-operative steroid regimen in adult patients. Dr. Sushmita?
In adults?
Adults, correct.
Okay. Nothing great, too early to start with for a week or two maybe, and then taper 2 weekly. And be very careful, as Risha pointed out, during the time of ligature. So don't be in a hurry to taper. And then slowly, depending on that, uveitis patients, my personal preference, it's not based on any data, but we are old school. So we were taught that the uveitis patients have to be controlled for 3 months before surgery. We don't do that anymore so much. But I do give oral steroids starting 2 days prior and then taper off a week later. And their inflammation has been much better controlled. I'm happier with that.
Anything different, Dr. Sirisha?
Yeah, so agree. But what I would do is during the time of ligature opening, whether it is 4 weeks, 6 weeks, depending on the suture that you've used, I will step up the steroids. Okay. Conventionally, what we would do is we will cut it down. Let's say because we are all used to doing an AGV. So what we do is like 6-4-3-2-1, it's a routine that you do. But then here what you, anyway, by 6 weeks, they're generally at 2 times when they come to you. So at that time, I actually stop the anti-glaucoma medications and step up the steroids to maybe 2 hour lead. And then slowly.
Prem?
The same, sir. I've already answered it in the question answer section.
Okay. So there's another question. If a patient has alpha allergy, how would you manage immediate post-op IOP rise, which is unlikely to be controlled only with anti-glaucoma drops?
If not a diabetic, can give manage with glycerol for some time. Otherwise,
I would prefer an AGV.
Yeah,
they don't have.
Okay.
I mean, sorry,
primary
sorry.
Itself. Yeah.
Sorry, not, Orolab, not to think. But I would
yeah, I think it's important that we plan that ahead of the surgery. Yeah. How different is TRAbLEP compared to RD apart from the location? So I think this is they're trying to compare a limbus based bleb as well as a posterior sighted bleb. So if you have opened the blebs, so to say, Dr. Sushmita, you can take that.
I don't know. I mean, a TRAb bleb is actually a bleb. It's a cyst where the aqueous is coming straight out into the subconjunctival space.
Right.
Whereas the other one is actually a lot of fibrosis. It's a capsule which has fluid in it. So this is not a capsule filled with fluid. This is just fluid in the subconjunctival or subtenon space rather. So histologically, of course, the difference would be that huge fibrous capsule. The location would be that. But I don't know whether we should call it a bleb also. We call it a capsule rather than anything.
Dr. Sirisha, your take on that? Anything different?
Nothing. I don't think we should compare at all. Because they are different.
Different things.
There's one more question. Are there any contraindication for RD in pediatric glaucomas? Dr. Sushmita?
Uveitis, I'm very, 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 very skeptical because the hypotenuse that I have got with uveitis is been late and I've had to go in and ligate in a couple. I've done a transluminal also. The other thing, what Dr. Sirisha was sharing was my concern also in post-cataract surgery. I've had one in which the tube was really encased so much that we actually thought the tube had migrated across the anterior chamber. And we actually realized that because of the tube movement, that tunnel of fibrous capsule had formed. So we went in to try and cut the tube and realized there's no tube actually, it's all. So I'm now a little wary about the post-cataract. I mean, we used to be very bindas about it, that, you know, put it in the sulcus and it's over. But in children, I think we need to be a little wary of, not that I'm saying that I would put an AGV, I'm just saying that I'm a little cautious. The more you do, the more, the less adventurous you are, actually. I'm not as bold as I was when I started out.
Dr. Sirisha, pediatric glaucoma, any contraindication?
Yeah, agree. And very large eyes.
Yeah.
Again, especially these children who have been uncontrolled glaucoma pressures for a very long time. Large PCG eyes with 6 millimeter or large corneal diameter. So those eyes I'm really scared of. So I would be very, very skeptical in doing. So if we do it, then we'll have to do it with an intraluminal stent so that you have a gradual reduction rather than a sudden drop. Whether it is an AGV, whether it is an RD, whatever surgery you do, when the IOP drops, these eyes go into serious problems.
And just one comment, Ganesh, that remember, it's easy to do the, I mean, as for all glaucoma surgery, it's easy to do. It's the stuff later that's going to come to haunt you. And the children, the growing eyes with amblyopia, with rubbing, with playing, they're a completely different subset. So where one trab, with trab fail, and the second trab, MMC, and then that was where we would jump in, but now I don't jump in. I'm a little more cautious. Doing a transilluminated DLCP one quadrant, that itself, you know, it's so innocuous. You're not going in again. Give it a chance. Hold on. So as we are growing older, we are stepping back rather than jumping in.
Thank you. Yeah, that's great. I'm surprised that both of you did not stand for a GSA election this year, you know.
We love to sit on the sidelines and watch.
You would have won the popularity contest. So just one question we have. I have a particular patient who has congenital rubella syndrome, FAKA, monocular, and very difficult intractable glaucoma. What is this? So, if a situation like that, a tube we did, but she went in for hypotony, and then we had to do a vitrectomy, and then aniridia. That's another. So I think limbus based trab is much better for rather than a primary RD. Would you agree, Dr. Sirisha?
Yeah.
We had a discussion in the KOS meeting also, I think, about this. So for aniridia, what would be the ideal approach initially?
Yeah, so limbal-based trab is definitely a good option. But whatever procedure you do, RD, at least in my hands, it seems to have worked better than the AGV because these eyes have a huge inflammatory response to whatever you do. So that inflammatory response to a great extent actually is in favor of a non-valved implant because it forms a thicker fibrotic capsule.
Okay.
And hence hypotony is much common. Whereas with an AGV, they form really, really thick capsules and they have very, very difficult. So trabs also, many times, in fact, I have done trabs in patients who have had half subluxation with literally the lens moved up and things like that. And I have done only trabeculotomy in several eyes where they are very, very difficult eyes where you just don't want to enter into the anterior chamber. So based on the case, I think we need to plan. But if you ask me the question, is a trab a preferred option in them? Yes. And would you do a limbal or a fornix based? Obviously, the answer is limbal based because you just don't want to touch the limbus at all.
So coming to the rubella syndrome, if it is post cataract surgery, probably the cataract has a role to play and then maybe a trab the trab or something. But if it's rubella glaucoma, that's also possible.
Right.
So rubella viropathy makes the trabecular meshwork dysgenetic just like PCG.
Right.
And in those cases, the primary ones which I have come across, a goniotomy has worked very well. So maybe a trabeculotomy because the corneas are, if they are white, then it's all right. But I have had CRS where I can see the cataract. So the cataract surgeon has told me to do the goniotomy first to clear the cornea. And 6 weeks, 2 months, the cornea has cleared. And then the cataract surgery has been done. And that has worked well. So that's just one caveat of rubella.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, madam. So it's close to 7 o'clock. We'll just have one question, last question. And there are a lot of queries for replying in detail. So I think Aurolab has made a provision where delegates can send the queries and they can forward it to the panelists, and then we can reply to them in leisure. So the last question is how to manage peritubular leak. So Dr. Sirisha, would you like to take that?
Yeah, so I mean, it's important to make sure that the entry that you make in the anterior chamber is very tight. And I always use a 24 gauge needle. 23 is easier for you to insert the tube, 24 slightly tighter, but I've never had a situation where I needed to enlarge it because I need to push the tube in. Yes, we have struggled quite a bit in some cases, but I guess what is important is at the entry point where we suppose we're making a 4 millimeter tunnel, at the entry point of the tunnel, I make it slightly longer. Whether I use 11 blade to make a longer cut and then I make the tunnel. So that way, the entry is actually the area where it doesn't allow the tube to go in. Once the tube enters into the tunnel, then it's quite easy for you to enter inside. So that way, that's a small trick that I have learned, and that seems to work very well. So otherwise, you make it tighter and never give up, and then say that I've used a little larger opening, like with an MBR blade and things like that. The tube goes in very well, and I try to ligate it around the tube after I place the tube. That will not work. Invariably, we will have, and I've known patients, doctors who have actually called or consulted and said that despite the sutures, it's still leaking. I think it's, especially with a valved implant, I think it's a malfunctioning valve. No, I think we have created a problem during the surgery, and I don't think we should blame the device, whichever device it is, because these are small things, but they do make a huge difference. Same way for an Adi, because I'm not making a venting incision, I will make a slightly larger opening so that the peritubular leakage will take care of the early postoperative hypotony. Never do that, because you never know, you have no control over it. You never know how long and how much. And that early post-op hypotony itself is sufficient for you to cause problems. So I think best is to avoid it.
Dr. Sushmita, your take on that?
Same. The only thing maybe if I do a little differently is that I also use a 24 gauge, slightly longer track, but it's just that when I enter, while coming out, I just, the inner opening, I turn it a little to, and make it a bit of a funnel like that. So the entry outside is absolutely snug, but inside, because like Sirisha said, the problem is getting in. So if it's slightly broader, so when you go in, you just turn it a little to either side within the cornea and then come straight out. So that little thing has helped. The outer is snug and the inner is a little funnel.
Prem, your take on that? Anything extra?
Yes, the same. The inner point will just make a little larger than the entry point. So even if you notice in the video which I have shown, I have made some sideways movements when I'm coming out.
Okay. And just a final tip is that if you happen to make multiple entries, you are not able to get the plane, you have to suture each track separately.
Yes.
You know, if you have two tracks close to each other, you can put an infinity suture and close it. But if you have got multiple tracks, you made 3 attempts and one is successful, the other 2 have to be sutured. You cannot allow it to remain open. So with this, I think we'll call it a day. In fact, thank you for joining us from 5 o'clock onwards till 7. It's been 2 hours. And I would like to thank Aurolab because they have really started off from Indonesia till the Middle East and Africa and covered the whole, almost half the globe for the delegates. Thank you very much, Dr. Sushmita, Dr. Sirisha, Dr. Prem. And thank you very much, Aurolab, for giving us this platform to share about RD. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Bye. Our speakers who accepted our invitation and to be the speakers of this webinar and shared your knowledge and experience with all of us. Thank you so much. Thank you for all your patient listening. Thank you all.
Thank you, Mrs. Sumati. Thank you.
Bye.
Bye. Bye.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, Prem.
Thank you, sir.